So the best choice here is E. Even though this is a benign lesion, the patient does need an urgent neurosurgical consultation. Let's look at some of the key features about this lesion. First of all, this is M mini. So those of you who have seen this lesion before, you probably recognize this right away. You don't have to think about it too much. It's important to recognize an M mini on board exam because it's basically a free point for you. But it's equally important to recognize an M mini in real life because you don't want to give an unnecessary long differential diagnosis. So the clinician may order a lot of unnecessary exam or going down to the wrong diagnostic path. By the way, for those of you who are not familiar with the term N mini, maybe that's a North American term, but it's a radiology lingo that says that a feature that's so specific for a disease process, really there's no differential diagnosis. It's like seeing your aunt Minnie. When you see her, you know her right away. You recognize her. You don't have to think about it. You know that's your aunt. So Aunt Minnie. For this particular case, you can see this lesion is at the anterior aspect or anterior superior aspect of the third ventricle, next to foramen Monroe. And that's its classic location. Now, it's typically hyperintense on CT, and sometimes in incisional trauma, it can be mistaken as hemorrhage, like in this case. And typically, it's Bryan T1, or at least 50% of the time, it's Bryan T1. Some tend to be a little bit isointense on T1. On T2-weighted sequence, which I don't have the image here to show you, it could be variable. It could be Bryan T2, isointense on T2, or sometimes hypointense on T2. So this is a classic example of colloid. So and again, an M mini. It's a benign epithelial cyst. However, unlike other type of benign cysts like arachnoid cysts, the lesion can grow. And that can cause obstructive hydrocephalus, and sometimes there are reported cases that patients die from acute obstruction. And here you can actually see our patient has a sign of acute obstruction with a periventricular interstitial edema around the ventricle on flare. So that is an important point to remember. That's why this patient needs urgent neurosurgical consultation. The degree of T2 hypointensity, the so-called motor oil consistency within, can dictate how easy it is the lesion can be aspirate. So it may depend on the appearance on T2-weighted sequence. That may determine which surgical approach that the surgeon may want to take. It should not enhance. On T1 post contrast, you may see a very, very thin rim enhancement, but centrally you should not see any enhancement. This is a cyst, not a neoplasm. So back to our choices here. Choice E is clearly the best answer, especially with signs of acute obstruction. Now let's look at choice A. Again, that's a wrong answer because this is not a low-grade neoplasm. For choice B, it's tried to trick you into thinking that this is subependymal giant cell astrocytoma or SEGA in the setting of tuberous sclerosis. Here we have a nice example of tuberous sclerosis patient with SEGA. Now, the location is great for SEGA in that it's adjacent to the foramen Monroe. That's a classic location for SEGA. But with SEGA, it's a neoplasm, so you should enhance avidly, unlike colloid cysts, which should not enhance centrally. And also, colloid cysts tend to be more rounded like a cyst, whereas SEGA typically present as a lobulated mass. Also, for our patient, there's no other sign of tuberous sclerosis. Unlike in this case, where you can see multiple subependymal nodule, here there's one here, there's another one, and there's one here. So choice B is not the best answer for our case. Choice C, we already talked about it. Patient does have show signs of acute obstruction or uncompensated obstructive hydrocephalus with periventricular interstitial edema. So the patient does need intervention. Choice D is on CT, colloid cyst is hyperdense, so sometimes can be mistaken as intraventricular blood. And I have seen incidental finding of small colloid cyst with patients scanned for trauma, thinking that this is intraventricular hemorrhage. But to me, it's always strange to have just one small intraventricular hemorrhage at that classic location without any other signs of intracranial trauma or other intracranial hemorrhage. And that would be relatively strange for just acute blood in that specific location. So I would consider small caudal cyst as a more likely choice. So choice D in this case is wrong. And choice E, of course, is the best answer here. So that's all for this M mini case, and I hope you find this helpful. Good luck on your board exam. Thank you.